Denise, number three. Which apostle was the first to plant churches that weren't culturally Jewish?
Paul.
Right. Crystal. Who made the most drastic cultural transition in history?
Jesus. He is the eternal word and became flesh, taking on the nature of a servant, setting aside his privileges of his position and power, submitting himself to the Father's plan.
Good. All right. Tammy, number five. Oops, wrong way. What is the goal of cultural adaptation and how can it be accomplished?
The goal of cultural adaptation is to remove barriers and to build bridges over which the kingdom of God can advance to an individual, a person, group, or a nation. A people group. We can accomplish this by first making sure we have the right attitude. Learn as much as possible from others about manners and customs, such as dress, table manners, gestures, appropriate interactions with the opposite sex, and the willingness to learn and adapt in these external matters will clear the way for meaningful communications and ministry.
Good. Lisa, do you want to answer a question?
Sure.
All right, number six. What is meant by an indigenous church?
A church which has come into being in the context of its own culture and people group, being self-governing and self-propagating.
Good.
Self-sufficient.
Self-sufficient as well. Okay, Julie, number seven. What is the main role of a missionary who is working under the covering of a well-established church?
I put the main role is primary to establish a partnership, a coming alongside to help and strengthen the church to fulfill its God-given mission, whether by teaching, medical, development work, leadership training, etc., all according to the church's needs.
Denise, number eight, choose a culture that is different from your own and identify some specific challenges that you would face in reaching members of that group.
I use the Hispanic or Catholic culture. I put that language would be one. I put that a lot of the times that they practice the Catholic religion, it goes back generations and like to their ancestors and things like that, and they have very strong family ties. And they look to a priest as a mediator for them a lot of times, and they do not know or not familiar with the scripture.
Good.
I left out the word not. So I wrote are familiar with scripture, but I really meant are not know familiar with scripture.
Okay.
Good.
That's why I asked.
All right.
But at least the food is not a problem.
So
I remember this one missionary that we knew, and he had an orphanage in Zimbabwe, and a whole bunch of like several dozen orphans, children that people throw away. And that he picked up, just started by picking up one and taking care of him. And pretty soon he had several dozen of his children, even his sons and their wives. And he was saying he was with this one tribal leader, and they were around the fire, you know, like out of central casting, and they were cooking the dinner, and it was a monkey that they were cooking, and they gave him the cooked monkey hand as, you know, like the Benjamin portion. I mean, that was the portion of honor that they gave him.
Nope. If it was fried, it probably would have been good.
Nope.
Crunchy
nope.
Like chicken wing.
Nope.
Did I hear a lion over there?
Yeah.
Like,
oh, see it.
Yeah, it tastes like chicken. Pretty sure.
I feel like he's trying to make this stuff up to make Americans look stupid.
You know who that was that I'm talking about, Lisa?
What?
Do you know who it is that I'm talking about?
Yeah, Mr. What?
That's right, yeah. That you remember. I think kind of get allowed.
I think once they get us to eat the monkey hand, they like are laughing to themselves. Like,
yeah.
You're probably right.
the Goa Man was on order another fake monkey hand.
Yeah.
It's really spam,
just
chicken wings. Spam monkey hand.
They fry it up, make it
I thought that this point or question number six, I left it up on the board, but I didn't. Oh, forgot it.
I felt like I was forgetting something because I was.
Actually, you had that plugged in. I think you unplugged it.
No, I really didn't.
Well, I thought you did.
No.
All right. So, the cable elves have not been idle. Put away a cable, nice and neat, straight. Turn your back on, and see that's my.
Next thing you know, they're serving monkey hand.
All right. Let's see. The problem is that this darn power converter weighs too much. It's pulling my charger out. I'm gonna back up a little bit. So take the string off of there. Okay, a little more.
That's good. Well, but it's kind of supporting by the stand.
Yeah.
Okay. Number six answer, I thought that is kind of, if you didn't remember anything else from the chapter, remember that. Tammy, you read a little long answer. Can you just go ahead and read the way that you gave that answer to number six? Get a little bit more in there.
A church which has come into being in the context of its own.
Oh, no. I'm sorry. Number five. Number five.
Oh, five.
Okay. Like the indigenous church is the whole thing to remember? You have to remember the indigenous church. Remember number five, though.
Five. Okay. The goal of cultural adaptation is to remove barriers and to build bridges over which the kingdom of God can advance to an individual, a people group, or a nation. We can accomplish this by first making sure we have the right attitude. Learn as much as possible from others about manners and customs, such as their dress, table manners, gestures, appropriate interactions with the opposite sex, and willingness to learn and adapt to meet external matters will clear the way for meaningful communications and ministry.
Yes, I'm on board with that 100%. Don't do anything that we can readily avoid doing that would put an obstacle in the way of ministering the gospel to somebody. So I'm going to take that off there. So.
Oh my God.
Good lesson. I just want to zero in on a few points, a few things where I think it was especially good, and a few places where I think it kind of off the mark. All right, there we go. In the context of this cross-cultural ministry, just a reminder of our core values. These are the updated 2020 restated. Same core values, just tweaked a little bit to say it easier. To love God, have a loyalty to the local church, a passion for the harvest, spirit-filled with godly character, and trained and shaped as a leader. That's what we're trying to accomplish in ourselves through these courses. But the passion for the harvest comes into cross-cultural ministry. So, I mean, what is it that makes you kind of, it's to say the least, inconvenient, right? Denise described, the gospel to Hispanic people. If you have a language barrier, that is inconvenient. And there's other barriers as well. So, it is a passion for the harvest to see people come out of darkness into light, to know Jesus and to be saved from wrath, that would, move us to do that kind of cultural adaptation. What is culture? My definition, culture is the way we do things. That is the way that any family, organization, group, movement, or nation does things. Culture flows from worldview, we talked about worldview, which is the beliefs about life that motivate us to think, speak, and act the way that we do. So when you think about culture, that's what we're talking about, the way we do things. And so if you know, as you've been maybe in different businesses or different churches, different families, you've seen this for sure, you go to somebody else's house, the different family will have a different way that they do things. Has anybody here ever gone on vacation with another family? You find out that people do things differently. We did a couple of times, three times, I think we've done that with the same family. but one of the things that we knew about their culture was if we were going to go off and do our own thing, it was fine. Nobody got upset, whatever. But generally, our policy has been we ain't going on vacation with another family. We don't even go to the museum with another family because Gail and I have a museum culture, you know, the way that we go through a museum, and we find out that other people have a museum culture that's quite different. So we read everything.
It's for their own good.
But
we don't go with them.
It's for them. We do it out of love. We don't take it with us. We have done it, you know, back in the day, and we realized this isn't a good idea.
Not gonna happen.
So we have our museum culture. We read everything. We look at every exhibit, you know, through all of it. And then, you know, there's other people that do it the wrong way. So they just cruise through there like they're, you know, like they're on their way to catch a plane or something. Okay. So no, it's fine. I mean, that's how they do it. So we just shouldn't do museums with somebody else. Okay. The gospel is for everyone, everywhere. Just a couple of scriptures that Dr. Leon brought to light, I thought were important. And there are more, but these ones, I think they give the scope. You know, we have the in the beginning, the gospel, and in the consummation. Genesis 12, now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. You could, you feeling that, Lisa? That what Abraham, you know, taking the instruction from God and having to leave his family and the place that he was familiar with and everything that he knew and go to a place that he wasn't familiar with, it's hard, right? God says then, I will make your name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. Here's the key phrase. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. It's always been God's plan to fill the earth with a blessing. Matthew 24:14. And this gospel of the kingdom, Jesus speaking, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end shall come. And then Revelation 5:9, they sung a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. Chuck Gerard singing back. That is the scope, and you could fill in spaces in between those with scripture after scripture about God's intention that the whole earth would be filled with his glory, his blessing, and with salvation. With that in mind, Jesus crossed cultures. A little musical moment here. Remember this song? Jesus, that's what Jesus did. He made it, he crossed a cultural boundary, right, between heaven and earth. They're very different. Okay. It's described there in Philippians 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. So, Abram left his own country and everything that he knew and went to a land that God would show him. That was a big crossing of cultures there in order to bring blessing. Jesus, he left behind all that. I mean, which one was better? Heaven or earth? Heaven's better. Hint, heaven was better. But Jesus did it on a mission. Okay, so he was motivated by a passion for the harvest, right? That is, Paul says, let this mind or this attitude be in you that was in Christ Jesus. So he laid down what he had going, willing to do that in order to rescue us. Whoops, here goes the music again. I just wanted to change. Do we ever get out of this slide? Okay. I don't know.
What chapter are we
on? I was thinking of I can't think while I was playing. The one I was thinking of was hard.
I know.
Music, oh yeah. Who will declare my name? Who will shout my name in the middle of the nations? For the sands of
time. The
name of a body. Yes, thank you. All right, we have to get by this little technical difficulty here. Oh no, then I just went back on it.
Did you want to play?
No, that's okay. But I was thinking about it. Though. All right. He talks a little bit about diversity, and Dr. Leon gives us kind of assertion that at the Tower of Babel, God was upgrading man from unity of one language to the diversity of a whole bunch of languages, and that was a good thing. To me, that is a theological stretch. Okay, why do I say that? Well, because what occurred at Babel was confusion and strife and division. Okay, do you know the story of the Tower of Babel? I'll tell it real quick. Okay, so this is after the flood, men began to multiply on the earth, and God had given instructions to Noah when he exited the ark and said, he just kind of renewed what he'd said to Adam, be fruitful, multiply, spread over the earth. Okay, and there was a guy named Nimrod, who was the alpha male there at Babel city. They built a city, and he was a mighty hunter, and he gathered people to him and said, hey, let's build this city, and let's build a tower up to heaven, and so that we can make a name for ourselves. And the Bible says that they were all of one speech and one purpose, and God is observing this. He's saying they're all one speech and one purpose, and now nothing that they endeavor to do will be impossible to them, will be withheld to them because of that unity of speech and purpose that they had. So he says, and so this isn't stated, but a lot of Bible scholars say that the reason that they were building this tower was because they just, what they knew in recent history was that when men were rebellious against God, what did God do? Flooded the whole earth, drowned everything. Okay, So they're going to build a tower up to heaven so that they have a place. That's not stated. It's a speculation, but to me, it's a fairly reasonable speculation.
Yeah.
But the one thing for sure they said they wanted to is that they were disobeying God's command to spread over the earth, okay? And they were trying to make a name for themselves.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They wanted to make their name great in the earth. Okay. And God came and said, you know what, this is not, we're not going to let this go on. And so he confused their languages. And pretty soon they left off building the tower and were scattered on the face of the earth.
Oh.
This is where the origin of languages are. So when God created, there was just one language.
Hmm.
And anyway, that was a judgment that God brought because they were doing something that was antithetical to God's plan for mankind. And so what happened at Babel was he brought confusion, strife, and division. And by as you read through the Old Testament stories, you'll see often that God will cause the enemies to start tripping over their own feet and running into each other and so on as a way of defeating them. So here in 1 Corinthians 14:33, Paul is talking to the church about orderliness in the meeting of the church. He says, God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. And Genesis 1:31, when God had finished the creation on the sixth day, he saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. So if the premise is that, well, having one language for all people on the earth needed an upgrade to many languages, I don't think that is a supportable assertion from the scripture. The problem at Babel was not that they all spoke one language. The problem was that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. They were in rebellion against God. So if you have your King James Bible, it says, and Nimrod was a mighty hunter before the Lord. But literally that means he was a mighty hunter in the face of the Lord, like we would say, in your face, right? He was in God's face, what people say, defiant.
Okay.
As for diversity, God created all living things after their kinds with the capacity to adapt and produce variety or diversity. So that word, without the, oh, I've lost my last quote mark, so I'm going to fall off there. Diversity is the same, essentially the same thing as variety. Different kinds that are different from one another, okay? And so a lot of things, like Paul talks about, there are diverse kinds of tongues, right? Diverse gifts that the Holy Spirit manifests in the church. Different than what I put in quotes, diversity, the word used now. Now this chapter was published back in like 2005 or 6, okay? Maybe written in 2004. But I think if we're talking about cross-cultural ministry, it's really important that we understand what in our own culture, because we have cross-cultural ministry to the unsaved world right here in our own country, in our own state, our own city. Okay? And language is a real dividing point of culture. So words are used in the language, it means something. Let me give you an example, because I'm going to talk about diversity, I'm going to talk about multiculturalism, some words in our language. Let me give you an example. If we were watching a movie in 1950 and say somebody was trying to encourage their friend to come to Jesus, and the friend thought it was going to be really boring, and they said, "No, come to my church. It's a great time. It's a gay church, right? What would that mean in 1950?
Happy, happy.
Right, man. It's a happy church. We have a great time. We're having fun there. Okay. What does it mean in 2021? Okay, right. It means that they endorse homosexuality. Okay, but it didn't mean so we wouldn't say now. We wouldn't just take up that word and use it without qualification,
yeah.
Would we?
Yeah.
No, we wouldn't. We wouldn't do that. And so in the same way, this word diversity, it has a very specific meaning in our culture. It's important to know that. So it was a perfectly good word, And it meant the same, basically, as variety. Okay. And God is for variety. Okay. Look at what he made. So just from me and Gail, if you know our kids, if you know all of our kids, I should have a picture up there, but I didn't think of that. But so from our DNA between the two of us, we made 8 children, and there's so much variety. So we've got children with blonde hair, with dark brown hair, with blue eyes, brown eyes, gray eyes, green eyes. We got one with auburn hair, and did I miss anything?
Skin color.
They're way different. Fair, so some are very fair, some are real olive dark, like that. The shapes of their eyes and noses and ears. Now, actually, you know, a lot of people from outside our family, they're like, "Oh, you're an Italian, aren't you?" You guys look like twins. They're like, "What? We don't look anything like each other." So to the outside world, you know, they look like that. But inside, we say, "Man, there's a lot of variety in here." Okay, so that's just and God made Adam and Eve. Everything that you see around you in people's color, their hair, their eyes, their ears, their height and shape and all that stuff, big hands, small hands, big feet, small feet, all that, noses, it all came out of Adam and Eve, okay? It's even narrower than that. It really came out of Noah and his wife and sons and their wives. But so God liked it, and just look at all the different kinds of animals that are all the different varieties of trees. Like we wanted to buy some pine tree saplings, right? What kind do you want? Well, just a pine tree. No, there's like 45 different varieties of pine trees. Okay, so you gotta pick. But God created all living things after their kinds with the capacity to adapt and produce variety or diversity. Okay. But in the spirit of being culturally in tune, that's not what's meant today when you hear diversity. That is not what they mean. In progressive cultural and political discourse, and that's where that's coming from, diversity speaks to a preoccupation with racial, gender, ethnic, and economic identity. This is the antithesis of the gospel, the new creation. Okay? In Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, neither male nor female, but a new creation. This identity, diversity, what they're talking about, if you say it in our, you post on Facebook, you know, you're having a day for diversity or something like that. This is what you're talking about. Even if you didn't mean it, even if you meant that we had a happy church, you say we got a gay church. Okay. People take a meaning from that. Okay. And that's the meaning that this has, a preoccupation with race, gender, ethnic, and economic identity. The very economic identity too. The gospel covers that too. James says if a rich man comes in among you and you say, "Come, sit up here in the best place," and a poor man comes in and you say, "Here, I'm the poor there so that I can put my feet up on you," okay, he says that's evil motive. So I'm talking about our culture right now, right here. So when Dr. Leon wrote that, that was kind of a minor little trickle of a stream in our society. Right now, it is a raging river in our society, and so we should be careful what comes out of our mouth as ambassadors of Christ in words like this. I could do a bunch of these, but I'm going to take these two because they're big ones. Okay. Multiculturalism and the gospel. So you've heard of multiculturalism. We were in a church one time where we had people all different. I mean, it was you had every shape, size, color, sex of people there that you can imagine. And the pastor would always say this. He said, "We're a multicultural church." And I just cringe when he'd say it. Why? Because you don't like having all those people. Oh, I love it. Every tribe, tongue, nation, kindred on the earth. That is exactly wonderful how God intended. It's not that. It's not having a bunch of cultures that made me cringe. It's what the word means. Multicultural doesn't mean in our culture now, it doesn't mean we have a bunch of people from different cultures. Okay. Multiculturalism means it teaches that all cultures are of equal worth and value. That also is a denial of the gospel. I'll explain to you why. Okay. When Jesus came from heaven to earth, crossing the cultural boundary between God and man, he came to establish the culture of heaven on earth. In other words, the culture on earth wasn't good enough. The culture on earth is needed to be replaced. Why? Because it was bad. And what did it need to be replaced with? The culture of heaven. Even though God had called out a special people and given them a set of standards, if you will, cultural standards, to try to reflect the character and moral standards of God, they managed to screw it up, okay? They were messing it up pretty bad. I mean, who did Jesus concentrate his fire at when he got to earth and started his ministry? Yeah, to the religious leaders of God's chosen people, because they had taken the culture that God had given them in the form of the law, and they had turned it into a club, right, of self-righteousness, of self-justification. And so Jesus came to say, hey, enough of that. Here's what the kingdom culture looks like. And let's read a little bit. Somebody pull out Matthew chapter 5 and 6. And whoever's there first, you start reading just Matthew chapter 5, verse 1. Let's just read those two chapters from the Sermon on the Mount, because it's a description of kingdom culture. I'll stop you. Are you there?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Denise, and I'll stop you and let somebody else take over.
Okay. And seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be great, called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven.
Okay, thanks.
You have heard that our ancestors were told, you must not murder. If you commit murder, you are subject to judgment. But I say, if you are even angry with someone, you are subject to judgment. If you call someone an idiot, you are in danger of being brought before the court. And if you curse someone, you are in danger of the fires of hell. So if you are presenting a sacrifice at the altar in the temple and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you, leave your sacrifice there at the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and offer your sacrifice to God. When you are on the way to the court with your adversary, settle your differences quickly. Otherwise, your accuser may hand you over to the judge, who will hand you over to an officer, and you will then be thrown into prison. And if that happens, you surely won't be free again until you have paid the last penny.
Nice and loud.
Yeah.
Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whatsoever looked on the woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out, and cast it from thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off, and cast it from thee, for it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. It hath been said, whatsoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you that whatsoever shall put away his wife, same for the cause of fornication, causing her to commit adultery, and whatsoever shall marry her that is divorced, committed adultery. Again, ye have heard that it hath been said by them of old time, that shall not forswear themselves, but shall perform unto the Lord thine oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven or by its God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king, neither shalt thou swear by the head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black. But let your communication be, yea, yea, nay, nay, for whatsoever is more than these commandments of evil. Ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, that you resist not evil, but whatsoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn it to him the other also. And if any man will shirk thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have that cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asks thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, do not turn away. Ye have heard it had said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy.
Go ahead, Tammy, you just finish the chapter from there. Sure.
But I say you love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect.
Okay. Amen. Thank you. I love the Sermon on the Mount. We'll stop there. You get the idea. Would you say that those things that Jesus is saying were countercultural then? They're countercultural right now.
Okay.
Everything from the start to finish. He's not done yet. He's going on. But love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you and persecute you. That's pretty countercultural. Jesus came to establish the culture of heaven on earth. So just a few verses later, his disciples ask him, hey, Jesus, teach us to pray. And one of the things he says, so pray this, thy will be done. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So he's talking about, a culture replacement, right? Culture replacement therapy. So that kingdom culture is described there in the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus instructs his followers to pray that the culture that prevails in heaven will also prevail on earth. Multiculturalism, what we mean by that, okay? And again, not talking about that we have all different, people from this country and that country, this color, that color, men, women, boys, girls, whatever. But that's not what we're talking about. Multiculturalism teaches that all cultures are of equal worth and value, which is not a biblical value or even a rational idea. If you observe the multiculturalists, you'll find that letter A, they don't really believe that all cultures are of equal value. For example, you never hear them saying we need to adopt Saudi Arabian culture when it comes to the treatment of women, right? Do you? No, because that culture is rotten, okay? Women are treated like dirt in that culture. Okay. So why not? How do they, where are they saying their culture is worse? Where they stone a woman if she if she dresses immodestly or if she walks with a man that's not her husband or father or brother, or that they won't let him go to school or let him drive a car. Maybe I might be able to agree with that part, but anyway. Just tweaking, girls. Okay. You say something, honey? Okay. But the multiculturalists don't go telling you that, you know, we gotta look at that culture and say, hey, it's no better or worse. We can't judge that. The second thing, B, multiculturalists, if you observe them, they believe that their own culture is superior. Because people that are teaching multiculturalism to your children in school, that are pushing it at you through every TV commercial and every movie and every television show, they believe they have superior culture. So that's what authorizes them to tell you how you ought to think and how you ought to behave. If they believe what they claim, multiculturalists would never be upset at people who engage in, quote, cultural imperialism, would they? Since that's just simply an expression of another culture. And as multiculturalists told us, no culture is better or worse than any other. I was in college in the 1980s, I almost said 90s, because sometimes when you get old enough, you miss these memories by entire decades at a time. But in the 1980s, when they were teaching us this twaddle in university, but now it's gone out of the university. It has gotten like when, you know, you have an ant farm for your kids' science experiment, and somebody throws a baseball in the living room and breaks the glass. Am I getting too close to home here? I think you got a lot of boys there. So. Somebody breaks the glass, and the ants are on the loose. That's what's happened with this, you know, multiculturalism idea. It's out of the university and into our life here. Whatever the merits of various human cultures, the culture of the kingdom of God is a superior culture. That's why Jesus came preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Okay? And human cultures are either better or worse in proportion to their conformity or non-conformity to the kingdom culture. So the more like the culture of the kingdom of God, a culture of a nation or a group or a family or a business or an organization is, or church, the better that culture is. And the less like the kingdom culture, a family or an organization, a church, a business, a group of people, a nation, the worse that culture is. There is better and there is worse, and there's awful as well. And so we shouldn't fall for that garbage, even though it's everywhere. It's in the air we breathe right now, these lies. And I'm just cautioning you as leaders, be careful what words come out of your mouth, because like we have gay church, meant one thing in 1950 and it means something else in 2021. So do these words. And as you're talking to young people or leading young people, they may not know, they probably don't know that there ever was another meaning than the one that they've had taught them. I'll give you an example of something, a leadership failure in this. I won't name names, but we were in a church at one time where there was one Sunday, kind of out of the blue, a baby dedication, which I love baby dedications, okay? But this one was a little different because, for one thing, even though we'd been there for a couple of years in that church, and the woman that they brought up was like, the pastor knew her, and I'm sure some old timers knew her, but I'd never seen her before in my life, and it wasn't that big of a church. So we didn't know who she was, and I'm sure a lot of people didn't know who she was, but a lot of people probably did. She was a single woman, and she was adopting a baby who was like a crack baby or something like that, where the baby was, you know, in a terrible situation, where it was definitely better that this single woman adopt that baby than that baby, you know, go into the system, right? However, you know, I was in my 40s at the time. I might be accidentally identifying the church by saying that, but I was in my 40s at the time, so I understood that this was not a standard. This was not a plumb line for the family, right? And if you had, if the year was 1945 and you had a single woman adopting a baby that was abandoned or something like that, the entire society, young and old, and in between, would understand that marriage between a man and woman producing their own children, being fruitful, or adopting children into a family like that was the ideal and was the standard, right? You could have deviations off of the standard for cause, right? And this was certainly a cause like that. But unfortunately, the pastor that was leading this baby dedication said not a word of explanation. He treated it just like if Cornelius and Denise were bringing up their little Cameron to dedicate him or something. Okay, married couple, their baby. Okay, what's the problem with that? Talking about cross-cultural ministry here. The problem is that half of the people, young people, sitting in that congregation live in a culture that levels marriage as God created it with every other form of getting together and having a family, as if they were all the ideal. I didn't realize. So you got a situation just very similar to that, right? So you are on a rescue mission, and it's beautiful, right? Which is not the same, as you know, as everybody knows. That's not to say, hey, this is the norm. This is the norm. But you're doing something that is way outside, over and above the norm. It's like we talked about Jesus, you know, giving up all this to come from heaven and earth. You give up a lot to do that because you love, right? And in this case, the pastor said nothing when something as a leader needed to be said. It needed to be clarified. Hey, this is a special thing. Susie Q over here is doing something. She really needs our prayer and support because God made the family to be a husband and wife, being fruitful, multiplying, having your children, and raising them. Not only is it a two-person job, so it's really hard for one person to do it. Not only is it a two-person job, but that is the ideal. That way he's teaching all the young people the cultural truth of the kingdom in the face of the cultural onslaught of the culture's teaching that marriage doesn't matter. Marriage isn't important. And so it was a swing and a miss by the leader. I'm not saying that to get down on him. He didn't think of it. I'm exhorting you. Think of it. The words are the weapons in changing culture. Okay, so don't carelessly adopt the words of the culture around us because it's not a godly culture. I was not happy when the churches almost universally adopted the language of fear and rejection when the pandemic came. We have language already given to us. It's the language of love and acceptance. It's the language of the power of God. It's the language of healing. It's the language of resurrection and no fear of the grave. Jesus gave us those words, that vocabulary. The church, almost universally, in my observation, chose instead to adopt the language of the culture. Big mistake. Don't let this happen to you, leaders, okay? We got to be alert and on our toes when that. I think that nobody had bad intentions. Church leadership, just all across the country, just got taken flat-footed by that. Don't be flat-footed. Be sober, vigilant. Your enemy, the devil, as a roaring lion, goeth about seeking whom he may devour. So. Those are just a couple examples of words that our culture means something very different than you might think. Cultural versus biblical beliefs and attitudes. In every culture and its worldview, there are attitudes and beliefs that are neutral, others that are positive and helpful to the progress of the gospel, and some attitudes and beliefs that are negative and which must be challenged by the word of God. Matthew 9:35, Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, the good news of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. Jesus was challenging the status quo culture that he was in. I'll give you an example of that healing in that. You know the story, there's a couple stories like this, but there's a story of a man in the synagogue on the Sabbath with a withered hand. Remember the story? And Jesus called him forth in the midst, and all of the rulers of the synagogue were doing what? They're watching Jesus, right? They got their smartphone video rolling, right? This is going to go viral, okay? Because what is Jesus going to do? They got a timestamp, so you know it's on the Sabbath, right? And so Jesus anticipates them, and he says, hey, got a question for you, smart guys. Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath or to do evil? And they didn't answer him. And he said to the man, stretch out your hand. The man was healed. What was the reaction of the guardians of the status quo culture? Yeah. They were furious with him. Okay, why? He's challenging their culture. The gospel challenges the culture. Jesus came to challenge a bad culture. Why? It was a culture that put religious rules over the love of God, the love of people. Jesus is a healer. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father, he says. God is a healer. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals you. God has good news, right? What is the good news? The price has been paid. You be reconciled to God. God has a different way to live, a higher standard. As we started reading the Sermon on the Mount, three chapters of it, very good reading, right? And it is very different. Somebody has called the kingdom of God the upside down kingdom, right? Because it's everything is upside down from the way that the world does it. That's a culture challenge. That's countercultural. Matthew chapter 5, Jesus calls for the replacement of the prevalent culture with the culture of the kingdom. He says, I'll let you just start to read it. You have heard that it was said by them of old time? And he says what the current culture is. I say to you. And he gives them, what is he doing there? And in those examples, he talks about adultery is one of the examples he talks about. He talks about loving your neighbor, hating your enemy, right? He is saying, you have a law, a culture that deals with the outward man. The culture of the kingdom of heaven deals with the inward man. This is Dr. Leon's phrase. I like it. Making adjustments in order to make a difference. So the reason that we would understand other people's culture and change some of the outward things is so that we can make a difference for the gospel. So you say, well, aren't you telling us not to adopt the ways of the culture? Don't adopt the ways of the culture that are evil, that are antithetical to the gospel. Of course. So Jesus didn't come down and say, oh, hey, you guys are doing legalism? I'll do legalism so that I can build a bridge to you. But he understood what they were, what was up. Okay, he understood what was going on. And I think that this is a good piece of advice, but it is not an authoritative piece of advice or a definitive piece of advice to make adjustments, to make a difference. We have to be led by the Spirit and be wise. There is a time to defer, right? A time to do what they're doing, okay? Like he sat and ate with the tax collectors and the prostitutes, okay? Jesus did that because that built a bridge to them. But he didn't become a prostitute or hire a prostitute. He didn't become a tax collector. God forbid, that is much worse. That's coming right up this month. But if you can build a bridge or take down barriers by some outward thing, like a courtesy, right? Learning the language. You know, obviously you're not going to learn a language of everybody, but like learning Spanish, great idea. If you can, or your kids can. Why? Because we have so many Spanish speaking people, you'll have no problem finding somebody to reach across to. But it's not a biblical command. Thou shalt speak Espanol, right? Thou shalt habla Espanol. The goal of cultural adaptation is to remove barriers and build bridges over which the kingdom of God can advance an individual, a people group, or a nation. Paul finishing up talking about love and being considering the preciousness of others, say. He says, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. Give no offense, neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God, even as I please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. We can qualify this by Paul's own actions. He did things that offended people. Okay. One time he struck a guy blind. Okay. Because that guy was interfering with Paul preaching the gospel to another guy. Okay. He did things that offended people. What does it mean in context? What he's saying? Don't make a nuisance of yourself. Don't be rude, don't be inconsiderate in the things that are sensibilities of other people, in this case, the sensibilities about what they could eat or drink or so on. But don't be insensible to people and what they care about. But a reminder where the power resides, we need to remind ourselves that the gospel transcends all cultures, places, and times. It is able to make itself at home in any cultural setting among any people group the world over, where it transforms lives for the glory of God. He has promised that his salvation will reach the ends of the earth. It will get there as we who are willing take it there. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. So cultural adaptation is not the power of God unto salvation. It's something, a tool in your toolbox that can be helpful. And he talks about missionaries and some of this, where they're trying to set up long-term relationships. Okay, that's good. If you're going on the mission field, you want to have that reference guide there. It's very good to understand that. But, so we need to hold these two thoughts. They're not contradictory, they're complementary. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Cultural adaptation is a tool to be considerate of other people's sensibilities so that you don't unnecessarily put a barrier up to them hearing the gospel, and so that if there is a gulf between you, that you may be able to build a bridge to them to be able to interact with them. If you were going to preach the gospel to, say, some Muslims, and girls, you went in with a slit up your thigh and your plunging neckline and your face all made up, okay, that would be, like, unnecessarily causing offense to them. But you don't have to put on the burqa from head to toe either. You know? The gospel is the power of God.
You reminded me of something. Michelle was on a mission trip in India, and she had cut her hair very short, and she called home and said, please send me my hair extension. My hair can't be this short here because it's expensive. And so we got,
this is like, yeah.
But it's true. You know, she had the sari on, she needed to have, but her hair was short, and you could tell. So once she got her extensions, we have pictures of her with her extensions, and then she looked more
So culturally,
so,
they were kind
so
of put off.
So culturally, they were put
yeah.
off by that because
yeah.
no one should cut their hair like that.
So don't give offense if you don't
yeah.
you don't have to. On the other hand, there's no point in pretending that you're that.
Right.
Okay.
No.
What you're saying is, I care about you. Okay. I respect you. I love you. God loves you. I'll give you one last illustration of the wrong way to cross cultures. And it was something, again, this is culturally one of these just profound mistakes that our culture has made. And it's in the church as well. Somewhere along about the 1970s, it was decided culturally that men should not grow up, okay? That grown men should be big kids. And all through, people start calling their school teacher Bill instead of Mr. Schnickelheimer, whatever. And there was even a little, kind of a outlier current of children calling their parents by their first name and that kind of thing. The idea was, and this was adopted in the church, still is, that in order for the adults to relate to the young people, the teenagers, actually, to relate to teenagers, that they would have to be like, so you get youth leaders who are like the biggest kid and trying to be cool like the kids, and parents, like Studio C, they have the cool parents, right?
Cool parents
skits, they do. The parents trying to be cool like their kids in order so that their kids will listen to them, okay? It's a huge mistake, okay? Again, Jesus didn't start buying prostitutes or collecting taxes. He came to them and showed them acceptance, right? He was willing to be with them. But what did he do there? He established the kingdom culture. He established the gospel message to them. He brought heaven to earth. Didn't take, like, strip down heaven so it could be like earth so that, like people would accept it more. This is a huge mistake in cross-cultural ministry. And the fruit of that, if you have, let's see, does anybody in here have daughters? We have daughters, you have a daughter, you have daughters. The fruit of that is what you see in the scarcity of men who are masculine, who are mature in our society. And so as a father of daughters, that's right. There was a scarcity, slim pickings out there. Okay. In spite of that, there are still good men out there, but it used to be the norm instead of the exception. So something didn't work there. I'm attributing cause and effect there. Okay, without proving it, figure it out yourself. It is the inflection point in our culture. When men stop being men, I'll give you a little test. Watch some television from the 1950s, like a Perry Mason or something, or the 1940s. And when you see young people depicted in those television shows, they're just reflecting the culture that's around them at the time. It seemed normal to people. I'm not talking about James Dean, Rebel Without a Cause. That's all. That's this new stream coming in. That's the beginning of this. Of the cruise ship turning around, you see, and what you see in young people is they're trying to, as much as possible, they aspire to be adults, to look like adults, to conduct themselves like adults. Adulthood is their destination, and so the whole society is encouraging them on the road to getting there. If somebody is not heading there, they are an outlier, a reprobate, and social pariah. So just look at that, because it's a nice little, you can take a cultural look back and see and think, wow, that's really different. Because what do you see now is childhood being perpetuated through teenage, through the 20s, through marriage, through fatherhood, into the 40s and 50s and 60s, and they wondered why we're not generating men that are masculine, that are responsible, that are leaders, that have initiative, okay, that are strong. There are very few, you know, compared to the total population of men. That is an example of cross-cultural ministry failure, because the bearers that should have been the bearers of cultural, been establishing a cultural stamp and bringing the culture of a child. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I thought as a child, I understood as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. Is saying, like, never become a man. You never put away childish things. Keep it coming. And because, why are we saying it? Well, because we want you to listen to us. We want you to like us. You know, the fact is that young people will listen to an adult who's an adult. And without that adult, like, coming down and being one of the kids. So on a broader scale, as ambassadors of Christ, the bearers of the good news of salvation, we want to be sensitive, we want to be considerate and be adaptive to outward things of culture that will help us build bridges and take down barriers. But that is a secondary and subordinate to maintaining the integrity of the gospel message, right? And the culture of the kingdom. Questions? Thoughts? Jokes? Next week, we got a new book, the last book, Christian Ministry. Did you get your book, Crystal?
No, I didn't.
Make sure we get that before you go. We're going to read the introduction, chapter 1, Who is a Minister? Chapter 2, Ministry to the Sick. It's good stuff. It's a good book. And right now, I just want to take time with, Shelly's not here, unfortunately. I want to take time with Julie and Alicia, right? Did we get to you, Alicia? No, we did not. Yeah, so Julie and Alicia will go to Alicia first, since she's farther along in school. And so I have two questions for you, okay? You can take, you know, a few minutes on each one. My first question is, as far as you know and understand, what are gifts that the Lord has placed in you for you to be a steward of? And then the second question is, what things have you been doing with those gifts in serving in the body of Christ? And the reason I'm asking these questions is I just want to, while we're in this, we've been together for 2 years, right? Most of us have been together for 2 years in class. We're learning a lot of things. We want to take the things we're learning and deploy them, be faithful with them, be productive and fruitful in the things that we're learning. And so for starters, it's good to know where you've been. And then talking about what gifts that you think God has put in you can let kind of match that up with, well, what have I been doing? And maybe is there something up ahead, Tammy, like you talked about something that you have a dream or a vision of where you think God is calling you and Jeremy to minister. That's good. I'd like to hear that. If you think, you know, in the future, I think we might be doing this. It's okay. If I learn one thing in walking with the Lord and serving in ministry is when God is speaking to you, when you let it out of your mouth, that releases something real. Faith is what it releases, and things start moving. It's true. And sometimes I've been like, I've kept my lips
sealed over something that I felt God was putting in my heart. And because I thought, well, this is going to sound stupid, or what if it doesn't work out? Something like, not kingdom culture thoughts, okay? But whenever I would speak it out, that's when things start happening. That's called, I believe, therefore I speak. That's the operation of faith. So, Olichka, I'm going to turn that thing off. You know what the questions are?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I go up there?
Sure. Why not?
I got some goodies for you guys.
I'm going to stop this because we won't put these on.